So we should probably start with the, because a lot has changed since I saw you in September. George has passed away.
Yeah.
What can we say about George?
You know, it's one of those totally shocking, you know, I mean, not that you can ever be prepared for someone's passing, but it just seems particularly startling and unsettling that, you know, on one hand, he was going around the country. He'd just been in Austin showing the film there, which mm-hmm. which played incredibly well, and he was so excited. I mean, you should just have read some of his Facebook entries during and after Austin. He was so excited. And then he was on his way to show the movie in Denver. And he'd gone there early for a rally for John Hickenlooper, who mm-hmm. was running for governor, his cousin. And we don't know really what happened. He died mm-hmm. in his sleep. And for all of us who knew him and adored him and had such an incredible experience working with him on this movie as a collaborator, it was really quite extraordinary. He was so alive, and he was so much like a kid, the strangest part of this process now of rolling the movie out mm-hmm. is not having him by my side for the next couple of months and having him in all of our lives. I wanted to work with him again.
He was really excited. When we saw him in Toronto, he was just, you know, over the moon, because I think he felt like he had a bad experience on Factory Girl, and this was a great experience, and he was very proud of the movie, and yeah. the whole thing was all very positive.
Well, and it was also that it really started to feel like, for the very first time, he was getting the kind of recognition as a director that people were giving the film such accolades, and he was getting such attention, and, you know, it's just a very odd, it's just a very odd and sad thing.
It's become kind of the rare case where you are not a producer on a movie that you are the star of. In the last few years.
No, I am. I'm not a name producer, but it is my company that produced Casino Jack.
Okay. Yeah. So how did George become part of your life, your choice?
Well, what a lot of people may not know is that I was actually cast in this movie on Facebook, which is slightly ironic since I am the executive producer of The Social Network. Mm-hmm. But what happened was more than 2 years ago, George had posted on Facebook that he thought I would be a good candidate to play Jack Abramoff. Mm. And then my business partner, Dana Brunetti, heard about that, poked George, as they say in Facebook lingo. They went back and forth for a little bit, and before I knew it, George was on a plane to London. And we spent an entire day talking about the script, talking about the story, talking about our mutual interest in politics in the United States. Mm. And then I signed on, and we had a really remarkable journey.
You've become kind of a prolific producer over the last number of years. And as you mentioned, The Social Network is coming, and that's another film that's being talked about for Best Picture consideration and everything else. Is that just a natural extension of the work you were doing as an actor, or is that a different set of muscles that you're interested in maintaining?
It's a slightly different set of muscles in that it's similar to the work that I have to do at the Old Vic, because part of, I mean, maybe the most important job in being a producer is to know when to produce, mm-hmm. meaning know when to be involved and know when to step back because there's something working. and one of the things, certainly in the case of Social Network, is, you know, when you get Aaron Sorkin and David Fincher on board, and mm-hmm. you just kind of go, okay, this is going pretty well. I'm just gonna let them mm-hmm. take this ball and run with it. But I think that basically the job is to bring the right elements together. And in the case of a film like Social Network or Casino Jack, trying to bring the right cinematographer, the right writers, the right director, all of those elements that come mm-hmm. together, because as we well know, sometimes with the best intentions in the world, you can bring together a group of incredibly talented people and still produce a turkey.
Mm-hmm. That's for sure.
It was always my hope when I started the company in 97. That I was doing it in order to give opportunities to first-time filmmakers and writers and actors. Mm-hmm. And you know, I always thought it would take a while to build as a company. and for it not to be viewed as a vanity company, mm-hmm. that we only produce stuff that I was in. You know, I am in some of the things we do, but I happen to really like the fact that I'm not in Social Network. Mm-hmm. It's so great to see a movie that, you know, I'm just on as a producer.
And do you carry a similar kind of pride, or is it in a different place than something like Casino Jack, where you're obviously so involved?
Well, it's a different kind of pride. I mean, I'm hugely proud of my producing partner, Dana Brunetti, because it was really he and Ben Mezrich who wrote the book Accidental Billionaires that mm-hmm. this whole idea of it as a film was born in 2008. And because we have a great relationship with Ben, we did 21, which was mm-hmm. based on his book, Bring Down the House.
Another hit.
Yeah, another hit for Sony, I'm happy to say. Watching him shepherd this film, watching how he got it through and into Sony with our pal Mike DeLuca, being able to bring Scott Rudin on, who's so extraordinary, particularly during a awards campaign season. Mm-hmm. I'm very proud of the fact that 10 years ago, Dana came to the Academy Awards, having been my assistant on mm-hmm. American Beauty, and this year he might well be there as a nominee. It's a pretty great journey.
That's pretty amazing. So, I watched the picture again recently, having seen it a few months ago, and it really struck me this time, particularly after we've gone through an election again, and we've seen all the Tea Party things going on, that Abramoff as a character is even more interesting to me now, because it doesn't seem like the morality is that far off of what everybody else is still doing on a daily basis.
Yeah. I mean, interesting, I think yesterday, the day before, there was an article in the Times about Tom DeLay and this trial that's happening in Texas, mm-hmm. where, you know, you look at how they raised money. What's alleged is that they raised money. They couldn't raise it directly for candidates, so they raised it through a PAC, mm-hmm. a political action committee, which then sent it back to Washington to the national committee, which then sent it back to the candidates, and that's the issue of is that legal or not legal. DeLay, of course, never was indicted for his role in the Abramoff scandal. Mm-hmm. But I think that, you know, maybe what George hoped with this film was that it would be entertaining, of course, because he didn't want to make a boring, you know, political movie about a lobbyist, but that it will shed light on what happens to our political process when money and power and influence wield such a sharp blade, and that in many ways dampens people's enthusiasm about public service. Mm-hmm. There's too much influence, and there's too much of this kind of thing going on, you know, and they're very clever. You know, they use Abramoff and throw him under the bus to make a claim that they're cleaning up the lobbying industry. Mm-hmm. And it's just bullshit, because they haven't cleaned it up. And I love how the sort of clever ways in which they do it. You know, you're not supposed to have a dinner for a senator or a congressman. You can't have a dinner. So then they go, well, what constitutes a dinner? And this is what it is. If you're not sitting down, mm-hmm. it's not a dinner. If you're not using utensils, it's not a dinner. So they're going to find ways around it. Mm-hmm. You know, ultimately, you know, will the American public stand up and say we want political reform? We can't even get election reform. We can't even get reform in terms of how you fundraise. Mm-hmm. They're too powerful. And the self-interest and the specific interest of corporations that want to have senators and congressmen vote in a certain way, as long as they're allowed to raise the kind of money that they're allowed to raise, we're always going to be facing this. And I think, you know, this recent election is an example of the kinds of money that was raised for lots of candidates throughout this country, and the reasons that money was raised.
And now corporations are human beings, so
yeah,
according to this Supreme Court. So they're free to do what they want,
yeah.
Different level. Well, yeah. But I mean, Jack actually seems to me, I mean, he's presented in a kind of comedic, reprehensible way, and at the same time, he seems in some ways like he's been sucked into the system, into believing that this is okay, this is what he should be doing. It's almost like a calling.
Well, I mean, you know, as he says at one point in the movie, you know, people are accusing me of selling access. What do they think everybody on K Street is doing? That mm-hmm. is exactly what they're doing. So, you know, what was interesting for me, you know, when George and I met Abramoff in prison, mm-hmm. was I'd made a deliberate decision not to spend a lot of time reading about him or reading commentary about him. There's virtually no interviews of him, so I couldn't mm-hmm. actually even watch, except for a few clips on YouTube of him introducing, like, DeLay. Hmm. So I met him, and obviously he may well have had his own agenda and wanted to steer things in a certain way, but nonetheless I met him. I found him very interesting, very compelling, very charming, very funny. And so I had this impression of him having met him. Then I went and started reading all the things that had been written about him. And of course in that milieu of our media, he was the devil incarnate. He was the worst human being that ever walked the face of the earth. He was the most ruthless, ambitious, greedy man alive. And then you go and you try to unearth the facts. Not what he said, not what other people said, but what actually happened. And yes, he did some bad things. Yes, he crossed the line. Yes, he overcharged. All of that's true, and he's paid for that. But none of these things like aligned. They were all like, well, okay, but wait a minute, what did he do with the money? Because basically, if you're going to set him up to be, you know, another Bernie Madoff,
right.
Bernie Madoff was clearly living high on the hog and buying Swiss chalets and jets and, you know, all. You know, Abramoff wasn't even paying his mortgage. He was giving a huge amount of money away and to total strangers. So there's this weird, all right, well, then if he wasn't doing what you all claim he was doing, which is being the greediest guy around and living high on the hog, then what did he view himself as? Was he like the orthodox Robin Hood? Was he, you know, there? That's what's interesting as an actor is when you suddenly discover that a character is far more gray than black and white, that you start to go, well, then maybe he was in a culture that was encouraging this kind of thing. And yes, he made a lot of enemies because frankly, he did it bigger and better and made more money than anybody else. So I find him, and I found him, a very, very complex and interesting character to play. And one of those characters where you hope an audience's allegiances are constantly shifting. Do I like this guy? No, I don't like this guy. Oh, I do like this guy. Do I like this guy? That's an interesting experience for an audience because it keeps them engaged and it allows them to participate in watching a movie rather than everything being, you know, explicitly laid out and this is black and this is white and he was an evil guy. And
it was almost like everybody saying run, run, run and just don't take the bridle off or don't get caught with the bridle off.
Well, that's in a way, it was one of the images that George and I talked about was that if we can have a sense of the energy that I want to try to bring to this character, that he's literally on the horse and he's racing and racing and racing and he never stops until he hits a wall. as well as a lot of the humor, which, you know, people may not expect a movie like this about this subject to be as funny as it is. But I look at also the work that Jay Roach and Danny Strong and all of us in the cast of Recount were able to do. Because there's another, you know, if you say, oh, we're making a movie about an election, you know, really? And yet, because the situation was so outrageous, because people's behavior was so extraordinary, because there was so much excess and duplicity and stuff that you just can't believe, that it's inherently funny because it's just did this really happen? Because you know you couldn't write this stuff, and I think Casino Jack has certain applicable echoes to that particular kind of way to approach a story.
Though 10 years later, it's almost impossible to imagine satirizing what's actually going on. I mean, you can't really make fun of Christine O'Donnell too much because she's too funny on her own.
Well, I mean, look, you know, the key word here is hypocrisy. And the key word here is role play. I mean, most of these candidates are actors. And, you know, she was a great example of somebody who was acting like she'd read the script. And if you're going to run on the Constitution of the United States, it's probably a pretty good idea that you read it.
At least give it a once-over.
Yeah, just a kind of a once-over.
But it seems like that's the truth in, you know, in all areas now. Like, there's a there's that need to kind of create that imagery that really has nothing to do with a connection to reality. And that's on both sides. I mean, I don't think it's untrue of candidates that are, you know, I maybe agree with more politically. There's this sense where the mythology is much more important than any of the reality. And, you know, the idea of job creation that we keep on talking about now, who can do it?
Yeah.
Who knows how to do this? And yet they talk about it as though it's a choice that a president has or Congress has.
It makes you long for the integrity and the honesty and the genuine understanding of what troubles that certainly citizens of the United States go through, from a Robert F. Kennedy or a Martin Luther King or other candidates through our time and politicians through our time who've really done remarkable work. Ted Kennedy having been one of the great lions of the United States Senate. Mm-hmm. And then you see a lot of people who, I don't know why they've gone into public service. And when they get sort of caught, you know, either with their hands in the cookie jar or being sort of just Teflon without any substance. And the fact that lots of Americans seem to buy into it is relatively disturbing. But, you know, look, I live in Britain now. I watch this, you know, with a certain amount of distance. I believe in public service, and I think it's... I think the problem with this is for people who have their eyes open and can see the charade for what it is, it probably makes people not want to go into public service. And that's a shame because it is a great, great, great thing to do. And we see it, you know, look, people can be very effective and not run for office. Mm-hmm. You know, we see it in communities across the United States where people get involved in something they believe in. They organize and I think that, you know, you can be effective, but the political sort of running for office is just, it's just become, you know, disappointing.
It's almost like we've radicalized the idea of thinking. Like that somehow that's now inappropriate and demanding too much of people who come, who are watching us. Like somehow we're just supposed to kind of go with whatever the phrase of the day is.
Yeah.
On whatever side you are. Does being in the theater, or and now a long life in the theater in London, a different speed that works, that takes you out of the kind of constant internet-driven, endless parade of this stuff? Is it a different muscle?
It is a very different kind of rhythm, and it's a very different kind of discipline in that the act of doing theater is a much more organic act. Mm-hmm. Movies are very happenstance, and they are kind of disjointed. Mm-hmm. People have to think of it this way. You go and see a movie and you see a performance, except the actor didn't ever really give the performance. You gave pieces of the performance over a period of days in different locations with different actors, many of whom you're just sort of meeting. And then a director and an editor put it together. They shape the performance. They decide how it's going to evolve. And sometimes you go and see a movie that you've done, and you know, a year after you've done it, and you go, "Oh, that's what they chose to shape it as." Mm-hmm. Whereas in theater, you get up every night, you tell the story for 2 hours. You have this remarkable experience of going from A to Z, and it's a journey that's much more organic. It's an experience in which you become a member of a company. In which everyone's up for it every single night, telling that story every single night. And while I love making movies and I love the result of movies, I'm organically more drawn to the theater experience. And it's certainly been, for me, now I'm in my 8th year living in London, our 7th season at the Old Vic. I've done 6 plays with some of the most extraordinary directors in theater. In that time, I think I'm a better actor than I was when I started, and I love
it. Just from doing that much work in a small period of time in a small situation.
Yeah, and also because of the demands of each of the plays that I've done, the kind of directors that I've had who have pushed me in certain directions, and because of just the fact that the doing theater is you have to be kind of like an athlete. Mm-hmm. There has to be a particular pocket of energy that you don't need as a film actor, but you absolutely need in the theater.
Did film become too easy for you on some level?
No, it's not that it became too easy. It's that I got to a point where after spending 12 years really focused on my own ambition, my own career, wanting to see if I could carve that out, I sort of got to the end of, you know, 99, American Beauty had come out, and I was like, well, that kind of went better than I could have hoped. Now what am I supposed to do? Am I going to spend the next 10 years chasing this same dream, trying to be in the hot movies, try to be on the list, try to do all? And I just thought, no, I think I want another dream. I think I want to take what's happened to me and put it towards something else, and have it be something that's bigger than my own career, outside of my own ambition, And that's what creating a company does. You know, your focus and your point of view is shifted.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted new challenges. Now that we're 7 years in, I'm 5 years away from leaving my role.
Mm-hmm.
I'm now beginning to do more film because now the Old Vic is running. I feel like it's been revitalized as a great destination theater. We're doing, you know, great productions that are being well received by mm-hmm. audiences and critics. We're expanding our work. We have a huge educational program and outreach and community work. Now I feel like, okay, I can start to sort of play more central roles mm-hmm. in films. I mean, really, Casino Jack is the first central role I've played other than Recount
yeah.
since I started at the Old Vic.
Well, maybe it's 7 year itch.
Maybe it's the 7 year itch, yeah.
And just doing this, now we're going through award season and this movie has been in the can for a while. Is coming over here, now you're here from England today, for instance, and you're rushing back to go do work and it must be exhausting, you're in the wrong time zone and all of that. Is it like jumping into another thing?
No, it's jumping into a very familiar pair of shoes because I've been down the road a number of times during this particular kind of season for awards.
Mm-hmm.
I've been through it, so I'm used to it. I have a rather wry ability now to look at it without feeling like you're in the middle of it. I mean, even as hard as I tried to not sort of get mm-hmm. pulled into all of that, it's you still sort of get pulled into it. And it's, I think now the distance that I've had, the fact that I believe so much in this film and hope that for George, more than anything else,
mm-hmm.
that people will discover his work, that to me is the motivation and the reason for going about and doing all the stuff that one does to try to roll a movie out.
And when you look at this particular performance, does it kind of just make you smile to see the work again and see this kind of breadth as a character in one particular movie?
Yes. I'm very, you know, it's a very, you know, almost larger than life, very theatrical kind of character.
Mm-hmm.
But I've also recently done a film called Margin Call, in which I play a banker who's been at a firm for 34 years, and it's a dramatic depiction of the collapse of the banking industry.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a very, very, very different kind of role, and having seen the movie, a very different kind of performance, because there's not a snarky, cynical, ironic line in the entire film
mm-hmm.
for my character, and he's really the moral compass of this story. And I was really pleased to see that, you know, when you look at, you know, that opposed to this, that I'm very happy that's also been an experience I've been able to have this year.
Sounds like we're in Kevin Spacey Generation 3, starting the next generation of your career.
Well, you know, there's a part of me that feels like I'm just getting started, so yeah.